financial decisions for themselves and for their families over the trajectory of their lives. We found, and the data supports, that women, you know, there's kind of a gap there between financial services and the information they provide and women's ability to really live a life that's what we call financially fearless. And what we also do is we look for top tier financial professionals who help women during different parts of their lives. We know education and training and information can only take you so far. So we reach out to the likes of Sherry and Vicky, those women and men professionals who are expert in certain areas that can help women when they want to, make an investment or make a change. In Vicky's case, I want to send my kids to college. How do I do that? How do I afford that? In Sherry's case, she works with people who are going through divorce or navigating that process as well. So we're glad to be here just sharing information. We don't sell anything at Purse Strings. We have nothing to sell. All we do is provide information and resources, and we'd love to get started and kick off a conversation today with Sherry, who's going to share her expertise on how to navigate those kind of conflictual discussions when it comes to divorce. Should we get started? Sounds good. All right, Sherry, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself to the group?
Thanks, Barbara. So I'm Sherry Morris, and I'm a lawyer by long practice and certainly training. And about 7 years ago, I shifted my business focus to becoming a full-time divorce coach, conflict resolution specialist, and parent coordinator. What does that mean? So when I practice law, what I noticed is there are some commonalities in conflict, right? You've got lots of upset people trying to figure out a solution. And I learned in pretty short order over the course of my years in practicing law that litigation, that fighting battles in court really didn't satisfy anyone. Most particularly the participants, and in case of divorce, it's the children that are most often harmed. So what were we to do? Because our family law system is set up so that people go to court. And in my case, I sought out some additional training because I had long practiced in the mediation space to figure out, how can I bring people together? How can I help them understand, even if they don't buy into the other person's perspective, at least hear from someone with whom they have children and shift their perspective a little bit and come to agreement for themselves, for their children, save the resources that they would have spent in court for their futures and their children's futures. And I was so moved by my own divorce about 10 years ago to make a transition into this field. There was really no one else like divorce coaches doing this work. In my case, I work with couples as well as individuals, which I find to be a really transformative space. But really, I call myself a conflict resolution specialist because I'm all about not solving the other person's problems, but how do we calm down ourselves so that we can look forward and live and thrive in the best possible way. So that was kind of a long nutshell, Barbara, but that's what I do to support people every day. And obviously, I'm passionate about that work.
Yeah, that's wonderful. And, we're so glad you're in Purse Strings. You bring such a unique skill set to our group, having been an attorney, but really focusing on kind of the whole negotiation, right? That's what it's all about, is really negotiating. And I loved what you said in terms of, you can only really focus on yourself. You only have control over your own self and your own feelings, especially when it comes to these really difficult conversations. So why don't you share a little bit about what this is all about and what you do?
So really what I'm doing when I work with people is teaching them a skill set, right? Practice makes perfect, or good enough, as I like to say. Yeah. Good enough in divorce is okay.
Yeah.
So when we are working through divorce and we need resources, it's really nice to have someone on our team who's going to help us de-escalate every point of the way, every decision that we have to make. So what I do is talk to people about where they are right now. What's their story? Where are they coming from? And then pretty quickly, we're going to try to move out of that story. So many of us, me included, get stuck in our stories, right? A story of conflict is really about how we're stuck, because what we're thinking is not actually impacting that other person, even if they're wrong. And let's just assume they are. They're wrong, because are we wrong? No, we're not wrong. So I noticed that with myself, with my clients, with people I meet every day, we can get so stuck that we can't see our way out, and the unhappiness sits within us. Mm-hmm. So I really give people tools to see a way forward and to first calm themselves. And I think today we're going to talk about some top tips for de-escalating. And the first thing I like to share with people is to calm themselves. Before you talk to anybody else, when you're escalated, it's just not going to be a successful conversation. I know, as you know, a partner, as a mother, as a colleague, in all the situations in which I'm escalated, no good comes from having an interaction with someone else. So I really often teach people to do the first thing, which we often forget, is to take care of ourselves. Mm-hmm. What are you noticing physically? And if I may, I'd like to do a brief exercise for anybody who's, you know, on air with us, how we actually calm ourselves when we feel escalated.
And let's do it.
Great, Barbara. So I really ask people right away to notice, how are you breathing? What are you noticing about your breath? Because when we're escalated, often we notice that jagged breathing, that really fast breathing. So if you notice that you're escalated, just slow the breath. Start to slow the inhale to a count of four. Take a minute to do it. Hold it with just a brief pause and exhale on the count of four. They're noticing, the scientific research suggests, that it's actually the exhale that matters. Mm. Prolonging that exhale to about 4 seconds is a really good way to calm our physical systems. That's really what we're doing. If we can calm our body, we can begin to calm our mind. Mm-hmm. So now you may notice when you're escalated too, your palms get sweaty. You know, your body is agitated. So maybe we're not going to do that right now, but kind of walk around a little, get your body moving, do something to shift where you are. Because if you're stuck in that moment, sometimes you can't get out of it. So sometimes just moving can shift your perspective. Mm-hmm. And then let's do a quick body scan. If you're feeling escalated, you might notice not only is your head pounding, but you're really clenched. Your shoulders are up around your ears, right? Let them go. Just let them go. Come back to your breath. In for four, take a brief pause, and exhale for four. And then really go through each part of your body. Let go of those fingers. Let them move. Notice what the feet are doing. Unclench those toes. Really notice each part of your body and try to create a physical shift. And by doing that, I notice, and I'm the one talking, I feel better. I really noticed that, you know, all that anticipation I brought coming into this moment and getting to this group and being in front of people. Just breathing differently helps that space. So that's really my first tip. I often do a lot of work around mindfulness, around, do you have a meditation practice? If you don't, I'm not asking you to become a yogi if you're not interested, but I am asking you to attend to yourself. Mm-hmm. Pay attention to what your body needs and start doing it. And start doing it in those moments when you're feeling escalated.
Yeah, I love that, because that can be used every single day in so many situations, right? I mean, we are faced with stress from the minute we walk out the door and get behind the wheel of a car, or go into a store. So much intensity is happening out there in the world with all that's going on. I mean, we're still in a pandemic. So I think you're right. I mean, in terms of really being self-reflective and self-centered in terms of what am I walking into? How am I feeling at this moment in time? And it doesn't take that long, really, to do a body check and really breathe in a little bit. So that's a great first tip. Love it.
And then I like to say to people, look, now that we've calmed our bodies, let's calm our mind. Let's bring ourselves to the actual situation. So don't multitask. Don't think about that thing that's irritating you in the background and try to go on with other work or parenting or, you know, interaction with a colleague. Let's try to create the time and space to focus on what's really going on. And that's not always so easy, right? As you said, we're in pandemic. We all have a lot to do. Technology is constantly invading. See, and just hearing that breath that you have, it's like, that's what I want to do too, right? So let's not multitask. So again, you know, intellectually we can say it, oh, easy peasy, but it's not so easy. So it takes a real intention to do that. So create a space where it's a little quiet and you can think about what just happened. What's upsetting me that my soon-to-be ex just did, or my child just did, or anyone with whom we might have a conflict? And let's bring our attention not only to what we perceive, but how we may have played a role. And taking responsibility for that is extremely difficult for all of us, right? Because we are embarrassed, we feel shame, sometimes humiliation over making mistakes. But if we can do that by bringing focus to the moment, we're a lot more likely to do it. So de-escalate ourselves, and now let's focus on what really happened.
Those points are important. I think also, like in a divorce, you know, it's not just the situation you're in the moment, but you bring to the situation years of anger and frustration and, oh, I'm going to get back at this person. You know, I'm really going to this and that. But what I hear you saying is you just need to step back and really get hold of your own control of your own emotions and how you're going to approach a very difficult situation so that you are in charge and you don't come off scattered and upset and angry, but that you're making very good cognitive decisions.
I think you said that better than I did, Barbara, so thank you. Yes, I agree. And sort of the 10,000 foot perspective is every client I have is unique, right? Every marriage is special. But there are patterns, and we see patterns repeatedly. And one of the patterns we notice in escalation in divorce is there's a tendency not to want to hold responsibility because it's embarrassing. And if our husband left, or we left, or we feel like we've let down our kids, that's just a lot. So the first thing we might do too is make sure we have support for our position. And that's why, as a coach, I will often refer people to therapists, because I want them to have a really safe space to be validated, to understand how their childhood trauma may have resulted in the choice of a spouse that they made, or the pattern that they're repeating with their children. How does it play out generationally? And then as a coach, I'm holding them gently accountable to these goals that we set, because one of the things in conflict is we really need to think outside the box. This is the time not just to get stuck in our position, because even if we're right, one of my favorite expressions is, even when I'm right, I may not be happy. And, you know, so holding things too tightly and closely doesn't bring a lot of abundant joy. So having a space for validation and having someone hold you gently accountable are both really important things in divorce.
Yeah. And you need to be open to a lot of this. You need to be open to working with a coach. You need to be open to working with a therapist and really taking in some, you know, constructive criticism maybe that will help you really reflect and see things from a different purview and really understand how you're going to get through this.
Well, one of the things I often hear, even when I refer people to lawyers who are practicing law with the possibility of resolving things in court for my clients, or hopefully short of court, is that, you know, they'll complain about their lawyers. My lawyer told me to stop emailing, or they're not responding to me, or there's a litany of complaints. And one of my complaints, by the way, about my profession, those who practice law, is communication. So lawyers, always get back to your clients. But the problem I see, the engagement I see sometimes with clients, is it becomes a repeated pattern. It's a, you know, a rapid response, an escalated response. It's reactive instead of responsive. Yeah. So lawyers are not trained to deal, you know, with the human condition so well. They're trained to deal with how we get this through court or create a settlement agreement. So they're not always prepared to deal with that, even in family law. And in fact, I think they become a bit numb to it, right? Because people are always upset and divorced. So they just stop responding. So what I try to help my clients do, and I think people can do themselves when they have conflict, is begin to self-regulate, right? And begin to be, and I think this is a really important phrase for people to learn, be responsive and not reactive, which is incredibly hard for people like me that are very verbal and that just want to say something lickety-split. But we have to reflect, right? Yeah. And what does that mean? It's time to consider the possibilities. And that's my tip number three. So now, you know, we've tried to de-escalate ourselves. We're focusing, and now we're going to think about what actually happened. And as you said, sometimes that's the context of a much larger and lengthy marriage. Mm-hmm. What happened to land us here, and what are we going to do about it? How much more of our time, emotional energy, our money do we want to waste? And I think it's really important to note that, you know, research about divorce, I mean, obviously it's a life transition, which is in many ways should be normalized. It's okay, from my perspective as a coach, if people are not together, right? As long as they know how to take care of themselves and their children. Mm-hmm. But one of the terrible statistics of divorce, and the research documents this, is that if we bring the conflict in divorce to our kids, they're going to get hurt. Mm-hmm. And there's study after study that documents that. Ask any adult child of divorce, or child of divorce, or teenager of divorce. And if they have been subject to that conflict, they sure know it. And they're more likely to have issues because of it. Mm-hmm. And we don't want that. I don't think any of us want that. Mm-hmm. So to take away the possibility of conflict in front of our kids means taking responsibility ourselves, certainly, but also doing better to take care of ourselves, because yes, if we feel better, right, then we can do better. And certainly all the parents I work with and all the people I know, we want nothing really but the best for our kids. So,
right.
So giving ourselves the space to be responsive, even in a difficult situation like divorce, rather than reactive, can really help with that.
Yeah, that's so important. And we're constantly modeling for our children. Every single one of our behaviors, from how we respond in the grocery store to how we answer the phone to, you know, going through this horrible and very unsettling divorce process, they're watching our every move. And it's important to be cognizant of that, because that's teaching them a lot of things. And I think with, like you said, it's okay if you're not in a marriage or a very happy place. I think you're also modeling that it's okay to move on and find a healthy place for yourself and your spouse to do the same, or your partner to do the same, and so that your children can still continue to bloom and grow healthy as well. So, but it's how you approach that and the decisions that you make and how you approach it, like you're saying, with kind of a peace of mind and very cognizant of your approach and really not trying to win in the end, but to be healthy through the process.
Oh, I'm so glad you brought up the winning, you know, the winning and losing dynamic, because it should have no place in family law and family matters. But of course it does, right? Again, the human condition brings us there. And one of the things I find is that it becomes really important to all of us to feel like somehow we're not at fault, or that we did better, we got the best of them, especially potentially we aren't the ones that wanted the divorce. Mm-hmm. So I think it's really important that we get centered, that we feel good about ourselves, even if we have been blindsided by this divorce. Take the time to do the work. Mm-hmm. Putting in a plug for Purse Strings, one of the most important things I do is refer to a financial professional, either a neutral who can help a couple figure out the financial piece, or an individual. If so many of my clients say, you know, I didn't manage the finances on my own, for example, I don't know enough. Well, let's find out and let's get access right away, because we want to make sure that you have the tools to not just survive, but to thrive. And feeling empowered is really going to help with that. So I always make sure that people feel like they're empowered rather than oppressed. And that means certainly taking note and taking hold of your finances.
Of course. Yeah. And that's a big reason why we started Purse Strings. I went through a divorce myself, and navigating that with other women, and I was in the financial industry, so I had a pretty good understanding of a lot of the financials. However, I met smart, bright, educated women who didn't, you know, and I get it. Women cannot take on everything. They already take on the lion's share. And so often they say, well, my husband paid the bills, or my husband managed that, or our financial person did that. So I thought it was taken care of, only to realize it wasn't really well taken care of. And those decisions impact her so much more in the long run. So that's why Purse Strings also provides financial professionals who know the plight of women and really want to serve a female market. So, and it's not just going through divorce, but it's at every stage of life. Be prepared. You never know what tomorrow may bring. So Yes, working with a divorce coach and a financial professional, and you never know who else you might need at your table. It could be a realtor, it could be, a lender or whatever, because you'd never know if you need to sell your house or whatever. So it is a team approach. So I love that what you're saying is it's not, you're just not the be all end all. You're part of a larger group that's going to support women.
Absolutely. And I think it's crucial that people have that support and not feel embarrassed about getting it or relying upon it. So I often use a visual in my practice that I'm standing beside someone holding their hand, and then there's this ring of people around us, and it really creates a circle of support. And that's what we need. I am helping you think through each of those choices and each of those decisions. And I'm holding you gently accountable, right? And the gently accountable really goes in line with my next point, that can be tough when we're de-escalating any kind of conflict, but especially in divorce. So we've tried to calm ourselves. We're doing the work of that every day. We're trying to create focus and get perspective and not throwing the kitchen sink at every decision. We're really thinking through what is this about? And now we're thinking about the possibilities, right? Now we need to get feedback. And this is a tricky one, I think, when you have any kind of conflict, because you can always find your yes men or women, right? Those who will tell you, of course you're right. And again, we all love to think we're right, but let's remind ourselves it's not always making us happy. So
Right.
instead of going to those people who are, our yes people, it's really good if you're working with someone like me, or even if you're not, to find someone who may not always share your perspective. Now, you don't want someone who's toxic and always disagrees with you either. You deserve support, but you want someone who can think more objectively. And one of the key notes about divorce is it's really hard to be objective. So it may not even be someone in your close circle of friends. Maybe it's someone you knew from long ago or one of these professionals, right, that's working with you. But get their perspective. Is what I'm thinking right? Is this going to make sense in the long run? Not just the satisfaction of, responding to an email that feels really good for about 10 seconds until you see that it's going to show up in court, right? So it's always crucial to have somebody say, hey, wait a minute, let's put the brakes on. And even if you're not talking to someone else, one of the things I recommend in conflict all the time is just set it aside for a minute, right? Like you don't have to be reactive, you can be responsive. So sometimes we're our own best judges, right? Because we know a day later that it wouldn't have been a good idea to say that, to send that. But getting some feedback is a really great idea. And it's a really hard thing to do because we want to get feedback from people who may not always tell us what we want to hear. But it's one of the most important things we can do in any kind of conflict or life transition.
Absolutely. In fact, coaches, that's what they're best known for, is they're going to see the situation from the whole perspective, and their whole job is to present that to you from a very objective perspective, to say, look, let's back up a little bit and let's take a bigger look at this situation. And even in business, a lot of feedback around maybe you want to reconsider this or that. People feel so like, how could I be wrong? How could have what I've done been, not the right thing? I always do the right thing. Well, sometimes we don't do the right thing. We're human. So having somebody have that conversation with us, somebody that we can trust and be honest with and share our emotions and our feelings with, but really it's about being open to that feedback.
It's really true. And I think after we do that, and it's not always possible in every situation to do what I really consider a final and important step when you're dealing with conflict, is to create some kind of closure. And it may seem like overkill in some ways, but it's really important because you want to say, what are the lessons learned? What did I do right here? What could I do better next time? And if we can start doing that on a regular basis, it's like 30 days builds a habit. It becomes reflexive, right? It becomes that habit of how we deal with people in any situation that may involve conflict. So I really do like to have that, Monday morning quarterbacking happen. I like people to think after the decision how they could have responded better, but also what they did right and what they did well, because that's how we learn and grow. And people do it all the time in divorce. And we have a lot of decisions that need to be made. We have a lot of information coming towards us. It's not something we do many, many times in a lifetime, like so many
hopefully
others. It's, unless you're, you know, Elizabeth Taylor. No, but I think that that's right. So unless you have perspective and remind yourself what's good and what may have worked better, you can't necessarily apply it next time. So bringing some closure, thinking through, hey, this is what worked and this is what didn't, is a really great exercise.
Yeah, I love that too. I actually participated in a divorce group, and it was around not getting into this same situation again, like doing just what you said, really reflecting on what happened, what brought you there, what were the triggers. You know, it really examined all facets of it and really had us journal around what do we want for our life moving forward. So it was more the post-divorce efforts on how to move forward in your life and, you know, have a joyful and happy outcome.
That's really great, because one of the things I see a lot, and it's, I think it's pretty universal, because all of us can fall into this victim status, right? Like, this happened to me, and that is never feel good because we're not empowered around that. So even if this did happen to us, our responsibility, in my opinion, is to think about what we want next, so that we are no longer, even if in this situation, to some extent, we're victimized or we're victims, that we learn tools to no longer let that be the case or not to let it happen again. And what you said, I thought, was really brought clarity to that, which is, it's up to us. We have to own that it's up to us to move on, whatever that means.
Right. Right. Perfect. So what are some other final tips that you have for us, Sherry?
Well, those are really the key ones, the five steps. If we can do that, Barbara, we're going to solve all of our conflicts and all be
all right.
But I think the main thing is, again, as we opened with, is focus on what we can do for ourselves, not focusing upon the other person, because we think, you know, taking poison ourselves is going to end up hurting them. Who does it hurt? It hurts us. So yeah. We need to really focus on, in any conflict, getting to resolution that empowers us. And that often means reflecting upon our role, even if someone else has done something egregious to us. How do we start, especially if we have children in divorce, how do we co-parent effectively? We likely have to have a relationship with this person for the rest of our lives. As I said, there was probably a point, if you had these children biologically, where you like this person enough, maybe enough several times, to be intimate, right? So if that's the case, can we figure out a way to at least show up at a graduation together, right? Like, so I really feel like it's all about that work and inhabiting that space. And I have a top tips list that I can share in the chat here. So if people want to download this, they can hang it up somewhere and figure out and really practice it, right? It seems silly at first, but it becomes habit over time. Oh, look, I'm in this heated moment. I want to get out of it. Here are the steps I'm going to take. And it becomes your ability to be responsive rather than reactive.
I love it. It's like when they go low, you go high. So so how do people get a hold of you, Sherry, to work with you?
The best place to find me is at my website, deardivorcecoach.com. I've shared in the chat a way to download this top tips to de-escalate. They can get on my email list. They can schedule a discovery session. That's on my website too. I want to hear from people. I want to know what's going on with you so that we can get to work making your life as good as it can be.
I love it. Well, why don't we bring Vicki in, since she's our admin of this group, and she's the one who created this group and has asked us to speak. And do you have any parting words, Vicki? Anything you'd like to add or share?
Well, all I can say is I've known Sherry for years and years and years. She's wonderful. I love her.
Yeah.
Mutual, my dear. My dears.
Yeah. Well, this has been fun. I mean, it's a difficult topic, but I think what you've provided is a great outline. And I would have to say, not only in a divorce situation, but any stressful situation that you're going into, you can follow those five steps. So I think Vicki could probably post that in the group if people want to download that document. And we want to thank you, Vicki, for having us in your group and sharing this great information. At Purse Strings, we just like to provide seasoned professionals to bring information, knowledge, and skill to various groups on different topics. So if there's anything else you would like to that bubbles up in your group, we'll come back next month and discuss.
Sounds great.
Sounds good.
Thank you, Barbara. Thank you, Sherry.
Thanks, everyone. See you next time.